Now we have a panel discussion on challenges and way forward in reducing inequalities through SDG 10. We have with us today three eminent speakers on the panel, Dr. Samar Verma, Dr. Govind Kelkar, and Professor Sudha. I extend a very warm welcome to all of you. Dr. Samar Verma is the Senior Program Officer for the Think Tank Initiative based at International Development Research Center's Regional Office for South Asia in New Delhi. He obtained his PhD in economics from Magad University, Bihar, and he comes from Oxfam, Great Britain, where he first joined as trade policy advisor before leading their Global Economic Justice Policy Group. He's also the founding executive director of Center for Trade and Development, Delhi. He's worked as senior fellow with the Indian Council for Research on International Economic Relations and published widely on international trade and competitiveness, particularly related to textiles. We welcome you, sir. Dr. Govind Kelkar is senior advisor to Landisa, New Delhi, which works to secure land rights for millions of the world's poorest people, primarily rural women and men, to bring about transformational change in communities by enhancing opportunities and greater social justice. Dr. Kelkar is also regional council member of Asia-Pacific Forum on Women, Law and Development, Chiang Mai, Thailand. She has previously worked for UN Women and taught at Delhi University, IIT Mumbai, and the Asian Institute of Technology, Thailand. At AIT Thailand, Dr. Kelkar founded the graduate program in Gender Development Studies and also the Gender, Technology, and Development Journal published by Sage India. She has worked extensively on gender and energy transition in rural Asia and has written numerous articles to scholarly journals with a focus on gender relations in Asia, being in close touch with women's movements in the region. Thank you for joining us today, ma'am. We have on the panel with us Professor Sudha Pai, National Fellow at the Indian Council of Social Science Research and former professor and pro-vice chancellor, Jawaharlal Nehru University. She finished her graduation and post-graduation from Delhi University and her MPhil and PhD from JNU. At their Center for Political Studies, she taught courses and guided research in the field of Indian and comparative politics. Her research interests include Dalit politics, state politics in India, agrarian politics, and globalization and legislative governance. She was also senior fellow at the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library at Teen Murthy. We welcome you, ma'am, and look forward to your views on the discussion. Today's panel discussion will be chaired by Dr. Smriti Das, Associate Professor, Department of Policy Studies, and Program Coordinator for MA Sustainable Development Practice. Dr. Das has over 15 years of experience in teaching and research in a range of academic institutions. She specializes in the area of public policy and politics. She has sustained interest in the field of environmental governance. Dr. Das also steers the South and Central Asia chapter of the Global MDP Association. On to you, ma'am.
Now, I think the floor was set, the tone of the floor was set very well by Mr. Jairam Ramesh this morning, and he brought in different aspects of inequality, ranging from income inequality to caste, and then going on to aspects of health and gender. Now, in this panel discussion, what we'll try to do is we'll try to get a little deeper into different aspects of inequality. Now, taking us a little bit back into the agenda SDGs, agenda of SDGs, if you look at some of the core principles of universality, or you know, the most important one is to ensure that nobody is left behind. Now, the numbers that were presented in the panel discussion this morning doesn't look so promising when we talk of ensuring that nobody is left behind. Particularly, Ishita this morning was mentioning the Oxfam 2018 report, and that gives us numbers which are quite bothering if we are thinking of an equal and just society. So in this panel discussion, we'll get into different aspects of get beyond the numbers to understand what really causes, and we'll also have our panelists reflect or give us a little bit of a way forward in terms of how we could deal or address these inequalities. Now, we'll have about 20 to 25 minutes each for each of the panelists. And to start off, we have, again, I'm addressing back to Oxfam's report, where they said that rich 1% held more than 70% of the wealth of the country. But what about those who grow food for us? The farmers, we just saw the farmers' agitation in Maharashtra asking for different demands. Wage laborers in infrastructure and other sectors, those that cannot afford 2 meals a day or those who cannot access health care, and we just heard from Mr. Ramesh about public health systems and public education system. What causes inequality of income and wealth? Is it inheritance? Is it lack of opportunities? Is it lack of education, skills, corruption? Lot of questions to ponder upon. And more important, where is the solution? We often attribute it to different causes, but we don't know the solution. Is the answer in better inheritance rights, better property rights, more progressive taxation, better education, better skills? We'll try to address some of these. Our first panelist will address some of these key issues of income and wealth inequality, broadly, if I can say, socioeconomic inequality, and which touches upon not only SDG 10, but 1, 4, 5, and so on, and lot of others, because we cannot achieve a sustainable society unless we have addressed these challenges. So I welcome Mr. Samar Verma for... You can, whichever way you're comfortable.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Das. First of all, my sincere gratitude for inviting me to speak to young people in the role that I play, and I've been playing for a long time. It's rather rare to get an opportunity to speak to young, if I may say, uncorrupted minds as I get an opportunity to do so here. So thank you very much for having me here. I also wanted to extend my gratitude to Dr. Swaroop Dutta and Lina Srivastav. I think they're not here. But thank you for having me here. You know, one interesting thing about public policy is that it's not public. It's policy for the private, made by the private, and benefits the private. And when I say private, I mean a small group of people. You can define it in whatever way you want to. You could call it kleptocracy, you could call it crony capitalism. But the fact is, public policy as a term is an interesting facade that hides a lot behind and reveals much less. And I think in some ways, Mr. Jairam Ramesh was alluding to, in his own remarks, when he was talking about how political economy has superseded majority of the evidence that exists on the subject. Yes, indeed, it's been true that poverty has been the overarching theme in this country for a long time, for almost all the plans. Inequality as a term has not been used in government planning documents. But as a reality, it has been existing. And anybody who just walk out of Terry, look all around you. I mean, I just understood that all three of us coincidentally stay in Gurgaon, which to me is a visible symbol of what inequality is, and not just income inequality, which I think is an important dimension of inequality, but it goes much beyond income and wealth. It goes into societies, it goes into deprivations, it goes into migrations, it goes into people, you know, how even UID, Aadhaar card, is put to use or misuse by authorities for the purpose of perpetuating deprivation and inequality and harassment is amazing in this country. Let me, I'll not take more than 20 minutes, that's all right. There are three key messages that I thought I will share with you on this topic. First message is, but before I begin, I must say that these are my personal views. The organization I come from, which is International Development Research Center of Canada, we are a bilateral funding agency of the Government of Canada. It's a Crown corporation. We fund a lot of research. We fund research think tanks. And I learned that Indian Institute of Dalit Studies is here. JNU has also been, we've had the privilege of being associated with JNU. I've had the privilege of working with Dr. Swarup Dutta on some of the work with ICSSR. So these are the kind of things that we do. We fund research. We fund research grants. We don't take positions in public policy. So whatever I say is my personal view and not necessarily the view of IDRC or the organization I'm affiliated with. But three key messages I want to leave with you today is one, that socioeconomic inequality is man-made, or let's say human-made. It is not natural, it is not ordained. Caste is an important factor of life, and I'll come to that in a moment. But this inequality is perpetuated by the 20th century economic system that we have, that we have practiced, which is fundamentally iniquitous and is plundering of the planetary resources. I mean, it's not a small thing. I mean, when I was in Oxfam, I was based in Oxford leading a team of people working on climate change, and one of the first stark data that was brought to our attention was that poorest 50% of the world's population actually contribute less than 10% of global carbon emissions, and yet they are the ones who pay most for the consequences of earth warming and other impact of climate change. So that's the first point. The second message is addressing socioeconomic inequality in all its dimensions, therefore, is a major challenge. It's not as simple as addressing incomes, addressing wealth inequalities, addressing state disparities. It goes much beyond. It reaches to the minds of each one of us. It's about consciousness of most of us. It's about how we have been brought up, with what kind of belief systems and value systems we have been brought up, are all factors which go into defining what inequalities are practiced, whether visibly or invisibly, whether intentionally or unintentionally. And the third, which is a little bit more relevant to the discussion today, where I'll try and bring it all in the context of SDG 10, and I'll talk about three primary challenges that exists in the context of SDG 10, but that's to situate my remarks in the context of the workshop today. So first of all, I mean, as students, I'm sure you know, but it will be a helpful reminder to just breeze through what the SDG 10 is all about. It's about reducing inequality between and among countries, within and among countries. And there are 10 targets and 14 indicators to do that. Now, what are the 10 targets? Just to give you a sense and to remind ourselves so that we are all on the same page. First target is fairly straightforward. Growth rate of bottom 40% of the population must exceed that of the national average. So in other words, the people at the bottom end of the income ladder need to grow faster than the average, such that there's an income convergence, as Mr. Jairam Ramesh was saying. That's the first target. Second target onwards, it begins to get into areas beyond, if I may say, quantitative economics. One, empowerment and inclusion of all groups. Now, there are ways in which we assess, we measure, but they are mostly proxy measures. We've not been able to define or design specific methods on how do you ensure empowerment. Are there matrices that can be used to identify or define how people are getting empowered, how people are getting included? And as I said, public policy is really not public, either in the way in which it is made, so the processes through which it is made, or in its outcomes, the impact of public policy, which again is benefiting a group of small group of people disproportionately more than the wider group of people. Third is about equal opportunity and reduction in inequality of outcomes. Fourth is about adopting social protection policies and wage regulation, regulate global financial markets and institutions. So you can see in a globalized world, addressing issues of inequality, even within SDGs, is no longer a matter of decision-making lying within the territory and the powers of sovereign governments. It goes into international decision-making circles, and thereby, you know, challenges begin to become a little bit more global as opposed to only national. Effective voice in international decision-making, so seat in Security Council in United Nations, for instance, or to what extent are we able to influence the World Trade Organization on matters of multilateral trading systems. Safe and secure migration and mobility, so movement of people across borders and within borders across states. Special and differential treatment of weaker countries. You could actually even think of special and differential treatment of weaker states within the country. International aid flows to help developing countries. Reduce transaction cost of remittances. At the moment, transaction cost of remittances are very, very high. So these are the 10 targets. And the reason why I thought it would be useful to remind all of us, because we are particularly meeting here to talk SDG 10, is to get a sense of the, as the introducing speaker said, the boldly ambitious, or some would even say ridiculously impossible, set of targets to be achieved in 12 years. I mean, we just have 12 years to achieve that if we go by SDGs. So this is the context. Now let me elaborate on some of the messages that I said. So the first message was socioeconomic inequality is man-made, human-made, and complex and requires deep structural reforms on multiple factors. And just by way of illustrating what I mean by socioeconomic inequality, just a few examples if I could see. So, you know, a girl child at home being denied the opportunity of going to school or getting a full square meal against, let's say, the male members of the family is inequality. Child from a minority class or minority background not allowed to socialize in a classroom is relegated to a corner of the classroom or has a separate section. I'm told, I've not seen the film, but I'm told that the film Hitchkey, if some of you have seen it, has a class 9F, which is the so there are sections. Class 9 has six sections, A to F, and all sections have students. So the top performers coming from, you know, good economic backgrounds are in section A, and section F are all economically weaker section people. Now that is a very stark reflection of the society that we live in. It may not be as visible in real life because it has to be camouflaged. Laws don't allow it. But in practice, studies by Indian Institute of Dalit Studies, for instance, has shown categorically how it is practiced in schools after schools where children are not allowed to intermix across classes and castes. Something that I have experienced in Delhi, for instance, as somebody hailing from the state of Bihar, it's not easy to get house on rent in national capital region of Delhi. I don't know how many of you have experienced it, but this is the Bixby, the automatic Google assistant, who's responding to my voice. I don't know how to shut her up. That's not what Google trains me on, but I'm just going to minimize the volume because she'll continue to wake up every time I speak. Sorry about this. But you can see how artificial intelligence is invading. And everything that I say gets recorded on phone, whether I believe it or not. That's artificial, but that's for a separate conversation. That's a work which I'm leading in my organization, and I'm extremely scared as well as enchanted with the impact artificial intelligence is having. But let's come back to a little bit more real situation. Or a woman worker, for instance, not getting equal wages for equal work. I mean, there are studies which show that typically for similar levels of work, women earn about 2/3 of what men counterparts do. Or a woman used as a proxy candidate in elections for constituencies where seats are reserved for women. And you may be surprised to know that this is exactly what's happening in the Millennium City of Gurgaon in Cyber Hub area where I stay. The woman who's who's won the seat from the constituency which I belong to in Gurgaon, was canvassed as the wife of the local sarpanch. If you ask many of us what is her name, I don't remember her name, but I know the name of the sarpanch whose wife is elected to that constituency. We had an opportunity to interact with her. And you know, she was escorted by her husband and her brother-in-law. And all questions to her were directed and responded to by these two people. That's inequality. Or if you're trained in Hindi medium or any other language, you know, then there are ways in which you get excluded from English-speaking you know, classes and societies and agencies. So these are all different ways in which inequality is practiced. It is therefore complex. We practice it, as Lina was saying, and I don't think anybody, any one of us can actually raise our hand and say with confidence that we have never practiced, even though the intent may not be to practice inequality, but we end up doing it in so many ways. I mean, to give you another example, there are studies which is indicating that in another 5 years, the amount of plastic waste in the seas would exceed the number of fish in the seas. Now, who gets worst affected when this happens? It's people living on the coastal communities, people dependent on the waters for their livelihoods. And who are the ones who generate this plastic? Rarely these people. So it's a double whammy on those group of people. That's inequality. But many people who use plastic bottles do not actually know that this is how they are perpetuating inequality, and yet we are all, in some ways, guilty of doing it. Thankfully, I don't see too many plastic bottles in this room, but nonetheless. So socioeconomic inequality, therefore, is extremely complex. It has its roots in structures. It has its roots in power structures, in societies, in families, patriarchal families, as you know, most of us, most of India belongs to. That's where the roots of the social economic inequalities are. It's in our minds. It's how we have been trained over a period of time. I'll just give you a few examples of the economic part of socioeconomic inequalities, which is only first target out of the 10 targets, so that you get a sense of the challenge that exists. You know, the topic that was assigned to me was to talk about why it is a real challenge. And I'm trying to give you a flavor of why it is a real challenge, and therefore, what amount of enormous effort at multiple levels it will require for us to address it over a long period of time. So I'm going to talk only about the economic inequality, and I'll only pick up the first target, which is the bottom 40% of the population. The target is we should try and see the growth rate of incomes of the bottom 40% of the population should exceed the national average. Now, this is the target. I'm going to read out a few data. Some of it is taken from Oxfam's work, but that's also because I was one of the you know, contributing authors to that paper. This was written when I was an Oxfam. Average wage of CEO in an Indian IT firm in Gurgaon is over 400 times that of a typical employee. I mean, look at the, that's where it begins. This is where the income inequality begins. I mean, how many years will it take for the typical employee to reach up to that stage? How many barriers, not just promotions, but social barriers, economic barriers, political barriers, it will take for a typical employee to reach that stage, you can imagine. There have been some data which have been shared about incomes, wealth, inequality, and I'm not going to talk about it. But there's an interesting data in that same paper which was not shared in this podium, which is, if you look at the perception of people on inequality, Oxfam did a survey of 10,000 people in 10 countries globally to try and see, does inequality matter to people? You know, it shows in numbers, but not everything that shows in numbers matters. So does it matter to people? Are people aware, conscious of the problem? The good part of the answer is yes. Majority of the people said that inequality is a major problem. Majority of the people said that they strongly believe that it should be the government's primary responsibility, not private sector, government's primary responsibility to try and do something about it. I said inequality is human-made. It's not God-given. Why did I say that? You know, again, I'm referring back to some data, interesting data from that paper. The extreme wealth inequality that we are seeing today is, you know, the people who defend the economic models, the GDP growth-led, I'm an economist by training, but I've increasingly become skeptical of the kind of economics I have learned and we teach. Forgive me for, you know, for saying this. But increasingly the kind of model which is focusing on growth and growth alone, regardless of how it is distributed, because as you might recall, the traditional wisdom in economics is what is called as a trickle-down theory. So think about growth, everything else will take care of itself. Clearly that has not been the case. But it's been known for a long time. It's not something which is being talked of or being learned only out of experience of, you know, 40, 50, 60 years globally. 1972, Donella Meadows' work on limits to growth, just to give you an example, clearly said that growth or GDP is one of the stupidest inventions of economics. It never is about welfare. It's never about the well-being of people. Kuznets, who's regarded as the father of GDP, himself was extremely suspicious. But these voices are, you know, as you can imagine, are not necessarily in the mainstream, and not many people know about it. I mean, I can give you many examples, you know, we've seen, which talks about how the GDP growth-led neoliberal economics has been primarily driving this kind of inequitable, plunderous growth models, which is by and large resulted in, perpetuated by the socioeconomic conditions that prevail in this country, resulting in the kind of inequalities, extreme wealth, and incomes that we are seeing. But people who defend this model often say that you need growth as an incentive for the efforts and the talent and the risks that entrepreneurs take. The reality is two-thirds of all the wealth in the world does not come from efforts, talent, or risk-taking. Two-thirds comes from inheritance, monopoly, and crony capitalism, call it connections with the government. Two-thirds of that income. You know, the amount of inheritance that just 500 billionaires in the world will pass on to their heirs in the next few years is equivalent to $2.4 trillion, which is the size of GDP of this country, incomes of 1.3 billion people. It's not a joke that we are talking about here. Again, as Mr. Jairam Ramesh was reminding us, there are three primary sources of trying to address this. Education, access to education, good quality education. And we know ASSER report has been pointing out how children in class 5 in public schools are not able to read and write and do basic arithmetics even of class 2. So, you know, just as an evidence to what is the level of quality of education that we provide. The quality of health services in public health systems. Again, more than 80% of expenses on health systems comes out of pocket expenses. They're not insurance. I would imagine most of us here have insurance. Hardly anybody here would not have insurance, medical insurance. People who don't have insurance are people who are not eligible for insurance products or are incapable of paying the insurance premiums. Who are these people? Bottom 40% of the population. So clearly, quality of good health care is also inaccessible to them. Talk of job opportunities. Mr. Jairam Ramesh was speaking about 10 million people entering the workforce every year. How many jobs are getting created? Do you have any idea? Every year in India, in the last couple of years? Any sense? 10 million people, he said, you might recall, are entering the workforce in this country. But how many jobs are getting created? Just numbers. I'm not talking about quality jobs. I'm just talking about the number of jobs. Do you have any idea how many jobs are getting created in a year in this country? Any guesses? it's 1 million, one-tenth. Every year, we are adding 9 million to an army of unemployed in this country, educated unemployed, people with degrees, looking for designations, but many of them having come through systems, public systems, which does not make them competent or skilled enough for the kind of jobs that are required today and tomorrow. There is absolutely no disagreement. I think there is all evidence which talks about importance of access to basic services and creation of jobs as an important way of getting out of this poverty. I had the opportunity also of jointly editing a book with Professor Thorat, who was the chairman of ICSSR, where we looked at higher education and the state of higher education and research in this country. And the, you know, I don't have time to get into details, but I can tell you the results are quite appalling. The inequalities are as bad, if not worse, at the level of higher education and social science research in this country. Now, in the context of, what does this mean in the context of SDG 10? And I'm going to draw upon a work that we have supported. It's called Southern Voice. Southern Voice is a network of about 49 think tanks from the global south, Asia, Latin America, and India, led by a think tank in Bangladesh. IIDS, Indian Institute of Dalit Studies, who I know some members are here, is a part of that Southern Voice. And they did a study on India, on trying to see to what extent can SDGs, they didn't do it only on SDG 10, but as you know, there's a lot of overlap. As Dr. Das was mentioning, there's SDG 1, there's SDG 4, you know, so there are several SDGs, they all overlap in SDG 10. They did a study to try and see to what extent are we prepared in India on achieving SDGs by 2030. And I'm going to just share some bits of, so there are three broad areas of challenge that they identified. And they studied two major programs, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, and another was the Universal Healthcare Program. And what is it that they found out? And it's a very recent study. I think it's published only last year, maybe 6 or 8 months ago. Three big challenges. One is data. Do we know what we need to know? Do we know what we are talking about? Interestingly, out of the 14 indicators just on SDG 10, we have data only for 7. We don't have data for the rest 7. For the rest 7, which we have data for, it's unreliable, inconsistent, frequency does not allow for cross-sectional, cross-country comparisons. And there's all kinds of issues about the quality of surveys, you know, underlying that data collection. So the first task, obviously, if we want to even try and assess whether or not we are on the correct path, is to make sure that we have the right kind of data. And the fact is, we don't. That comes out not only in the two schemes that IIDS has studied under the Southern Voice Network, but it also comes out of several other studies that has been done for all of the SDGs. The other challenge is around equitably meeting the needs of different sections of population with common strategies. So in other words, direct inequality question, direct question about bottom 40% of the population, which is the target number one. It talks of lack of participatory planning, lack of accountability, and lack of monitoring at local level. And caste, of course, as Mr. Jairam Ramesh was usefully reminding us, is a major factor at the local level. So the means of implementation and the implementation gap at the local level is huge. That's where the real challenge is. There's also some other papers which have been done, but you know, I'm not going to talk about it. So the clear need that we have directly emerging out of this is that we need to know what we were talking about. It cannot be based on anecdotal evidence or stuff around individual estimates. In terms of ways forward for socioeconomic inequalities, in addition to addressing the economic part of inequality, which you know I think Jairam Ramesh spoke of quite eloquently, and there's a lot of evidence to support about the three things that he spoke of. So I'll skip that part. But I think we need to go back to those minds which are not corrupted yet. And I personally certainly am of the opinion that we need to go to schools. That's where education needs to begin if we want to tackle inequality. I mean, the big picture to me is that, you know, coming back to the principal point I made, which is that socioeconomic inequality is, it's a hydra-headed monster with multiple dimensions. Some of it visible, some of it is invisible, some of it is economic, some of it is ideological, some of it comes out of intent, some out of ignorance. But all of it plays a role, and all of it need to be tackled at the level of minds and at the level of education. And education is probably the best and perhaps the only liberating force to do that. In terms of short-run responses, inheritance tax that he was talking about, one possible way, but job creation is very important. I have personally been of the opinion for a long time that if we want to improve the public health delivery systems in this country, as one of you raised in the morning, a simple way, an effective way, is to make sure that public officials have a stake in the services provided by public officials. So long as they are able to succeed and move away from public systems, in my view, it's not going to improve. There has to be a stake from public officials. Public officials, children need to go to public schools. Their friends and relatives and children and you know, sons and daughters need to go to public health systems. Until that happens, you know, it'll remain an aspiration, and quite honestly, it'll be difficult to achieve that goal. And structural solution, as I said, in my view, is getting to schools and trying to begin to educate them. Let me just conclude by, you know, there's an interesting quote that I was reminded of while listening to Mr. Jairam Ramesh, you know, and he was talking about inequalities, and one important inequality also exists among the social science disciplines. You know, economics has indeed overtaken all other social sciences over a period of time. I'm an economist by training, don't get me wrong. It's something which is very useful. We are very proud of it. But I think as a result of which, what has happened is, I think Tim Jackson, who's one of the economists, put it very very briskly and very aptly. We are persuaded to spend money on things we don't need. We are persuaded to spend money that we don't have on things that we don't need, to make impressions that won't last, and on people who, in any case, don't care about you. That, I think, is the sum and substance of the economic model, and I think it's important to revisit some of the basic idioms. You know, as one of the Supreme Court, and this is my last statement, one of the Supreme Court justice said, U.S. justice said, you can either have democracy or you could have concentration of wealth in the hands of few. You can't have both. And that's a choice that I think starkly presents to us, and we have to make that choice. But let me conclude here and thank you for the opportunity. Again.
Thank you very much, Dr. Verma, for very nicely bringing out the complexities and to say that, you know, starting from the your first sentences where you talked about, you know, public policy, I think that takes us to the crux of everything. Yeah. That how do we talk of reforming the policy processes? And when you talk about come to structural reforms, identifying different kind of problems, how do we start rebuilding these processes? And I think education, as per your suggestion, is one of the most critical entry points, and right from the school level to start, you know, inducing those elements into the system. Of course, we looking at different worldviews and economists, I was very glad that you brought that point up, because these disciplinary inequalities are really never pointed out. And they are one of the crucial critical factors in not being able to challenge the policy processes, because rest, everything comes as an add-on, while you have growth as the, you know, impending force. I mean, growth is a critical force. I think it brings us also into the second point of market is not the panacea. And when you pointed out that perception survey where people feel that there is an inequality and state needs to address it, I think it's a very good point in terms of reaffirming that faith in the state and state institutions to be able to address it, because market is not an equal force by any means. So I think we need to ponder, delve a little deeper into different elements of this debate. Thank you so much for those insights. From there, we'll move on to our second panelist for the day, Dr. Govind Kelkar, and who will address the gender gaps when looking at SDG 10. Now, when we talk about inequalities, we just kind of bring gender, or you know, as a group, as a disadvantaged, discriminated, I don't know, I feel very bad as a woman to be identified as part of the, you know, that minority group. No, we are not the minority. So I think that that worldview needs to change. Now, the problems of gender inequality are much more complex than we understand. I'll just bring in a few points from Professor Kelkar's studies. I'm just citing from some of the factors that you had identified in one of your papers, which talks of lack of recognition of women's rights and strategic needs, requirement of approval from the family or the spouse for travel or mobility. And this is not just rural. Probably it's less in rural areas, remoter areas, more so in urban areas. And I feel aghast to see this this cultural mindset being reverberated. Cultural taboos on women's freedom to assert their rights to own land and productive assets. We brought a lot of reforms in the inheritance laws and property laws, but still we feel very bad if, you know, if a sister comes and claims her right to assets. Lack of finances or property of their own required for an independent existence. The state neglect in provisioning of adequate services and protection of women from violence within home and outside. But if I can just add to it, is when we carry these mindsets, it's a form of much more serious violence against women. And unless we are able to address this inequality, we are nowhere close to any of the SDGs, forget about SDG 10. So to discuss the gender concerns and opportunities in achieving SDG 10, I would invite Professor Kelkar to the dance.
So I will be brief, try to say that. But what really I wanted to address that SDG 10, Sustainable Development Goal 10, talks of reduce inequality within and among countries. And I'm going to talk about reducing inequality within the country. So this is the, and this is the first time. There have been a lot of debate where North and South things have been discussed. But the inequality within the country, and that is very important that we discuss. So there is a, you heard about the scheduled castes, indigenous people, or the so-called tribals, and tribals don't like to be called, so our language also need to be corrected. Indigenous people, and these are the things that we are going to discuss. I will particularly focus on the women question, and within the kind of context of how these are created and perpetuated, and what is being done with regard to this. So I think the targets from, you heard from Dr. Samar Verma very well, so I'm not repeating the targets kind of thing, but two principles are important. One is the inclusion of all. And when we talk of the inclusion of women, and then we are talking of the 48% of the population. And women are not vulnerable, they are made vulnerable, or they are treated as vulnerable. In fact, in the whole feminist analysis, the new term is coming that women are not vulnerable, because by calling them vulnerable, you are denying their agency. So I will come to that. So I have been engaged in concept, Second principle is leave no one behind. So SDG policy is also this thing. So we cannot leave Dalits, We cannot, in the context of India, we cannot leave indigenous people, the so-called tribal, and we cannot leave women. These are the kind of marginalized groups are called. So the world is almost divided between the marginalized people and the marginalizers, those who make them the marginalizer. So I have been engaged with the conceptualizing gendered power in politics of transition. How gender just energy transition you can make, because this is Terry, and I thought, and I've been working on energy. I was earlier teaching in the Asian Institute of Technology, where I started working on information technology, how the gender question is important in information technology, how it is important in energy, how it is important with regard to the land rights and inheritance rights, which you very well pointed out, how much wealth is generated through inheritance, and women don't have these rights. These are called as the male domain. Both technology and the land, they are treated as the male domain. You have sisters, daughters, mothers, and nobody has inherited kind of any land. This is very rare kind of thing situation would be when they would inherit. But this is also the question of, just giving the background, that it is not that they are not working in agriculture. So it is even denied the economic benefits or economic remuneration which they should get for their work. That is also not, that is also denied. They are agricultural laborers. They are not called, officially they are not known as farmers. They are called agricultural workers, and they don't have the scheme. 79% of the women, rural women, are working in agriculture, according to the official government records. It is not really the kind of this thing. And only 12.8% women are operational holders. So operational holders are not owners. We don't collect the data on the... And India is very good in data collection. Why don't you collect the data? It's not important. Women are subsumed under the category of men. That is the whole gender question and inclusion comes. But when it comes to the right to vote, then we are individuals. When you have the right to tax, or the state has the right to tax, then you are individuals. So you cannot really, because some people think talking of the individualization right is really a Western concept. It is not Western concept. You don't teach the head of the household, which are usually men, and say entire household is educated. Okay, everyone has to develop one's capability. Every child, girl, boy, that has to be. In the same way, they need to have economic rights. Then only they can develop. So that is what one of the things. Now let me talk of the, what are the gender gaps? One of the things that were being discussed. Gender gaps prevails at vertical and horizontal level. At vertical level, in policy we find, in law we find, and in community leadership, and also in the parliament, we find the gender gaps, not in the same proportion. And why they are 40% in the population? Both in India and China. Because there is a female infanticide, there is a feticide of the girl child, you know about that. So it is not an accident of kind of natural that they are not born. So this is the so-called, in the land of Gandhi, these things happen, that boy child is preferred and the girl child is eliminated. So gender gaps are really at a very kind of, at a very deeper level, and that, and within our culture, there are two sources of gender gap. One source is women's inequality in the cultural norms. So it is the culture, our daughter, my sister won't inherit land, okay? This is what kind of thing. We don't allow her to go out of the house, unescorted after 8. She can't have boyfriends, otherwise she will be attacked in the outside. Okay, she can't have any friends kind of thing, that is the, because without permission, there are in Haryana and in Western UP, where next to NCR, she can't have the mobile phone in this technological age. Why she can't have the mobile phone? She might talk to a boyfriend. She might, I mean, this is the sexual control or sexuality control, which is very important for young people. For everybody it is important. Why only for young people? But particularly, since young people are controlled, when they can use the mobile phones in Meerut or what was the district, it was decided, when she's mother of two children, then she can use the mobile phone on her own. This is the age we are talking about. So it is really very, we are talking as if the middle ages, this is the thing. So what are these? So in policy, law, community leaderships, and also to national leaderships or state level leadership, these are called discrimination or at the horizontal, at the vertical level. Horizontal level, more important. Among women and men, and women are also complicit that. It is not really the only the men's problem. Women also, we also internalize these things, then only the minds are colonized. In different social groups, how does multi, one is women's dependency on men, both economic and emotional. That is what one thing. One is nurtured into this, and you can think about ki what kind of this happens. Second is lack of right to decision making, within home, outside home, in parliament, in formal bodies. There are many government offices, where the women will be serving tea besides and won't be able to have to ask the boss ki what to do. Because this is the internalization that takes place. Limit to women's mobility, I just talked about, and Madam Dr. Das also explained. And gender pay gaps in formal and informal employment. Samar Verma, he gave the figures, what is there. And why women are concentrated in the informal sector? Seva figures say 90% women are concentrated in informal sector, where they don't have any labor rights or right to unionize on maternity leave and other things. Lack of right to unmediated ownership of inheritance, land and property. This is very, very important. Even when the laws are made, they are talking of the, on the one hand, in the 12th five-year plan, the government says in one line, or the plan says in one line, policy says in one line, joint pattas have not worked. Patta is the title deed. But whenever the programs are made, they are made for joint pattas. That means that those who are powerful, either husband or the brother, they will still continue to remain powerful because you don't have unmediated right. Unmediated means through the household or the head of the household. And where is the head of the household concept has also come? I don't know, we learned from the British Victorian time or what, because this head of the household is created only in economic rights. In political rights, it doesn't come in decision making. So what is the meaning? As if the household cannot function without the head, while the decisions are made. Gender-based violence, not for transgression of social norms. So when the Nirbhaya case came, what was the one thing that alarmed me? That man, that film was India's Daughters. One of the, he interviewed and he said, if she had not resisted, if she had not abused, I would not have murdered her. I would have let her go. So the question it retort is seeing in this way, and that is very important. So your assertion is completely kind of being defaced. And this is both for men and women, because you are kind of part, we are all part of this system. Non-recognition of the work that women do. What is the major work that women do, most of the women? From 4 o'clock, child rearing, cooking, cleaning, and office, okay, and not office, agriculture work. But your that work, most of agriculture work has become now the part of the informal work or like housework. And they call it feminization of agriculture, but actually it is feminization of agriculture labor, because you don't have the right. So this non-recognition of, so we call it social reproduction, is completely kind of, is not denied. In the Indian census of last census, 2011, it says housework is not recognized as work. So you work from day to whole day, or more than entire day, and then your work is, you are not a worker. You are just become a consumer, and that's why you are a liability. This is the discrimination that we are talking of, the horizontal level, that policies and laws are not so kind of non-discriminatory and don't promote this. That would be the... Now, this is a change in SDG, and this is important. For the first time in the history, economists have been challenged, and by feminist economists, and this battle has been going on in India and outside, that paid and unpaid work both will be recognized as work. So this would be important, that there has been, I don't need to say critique of economist, because he himself has done it, and I have an economist at home, so that is not really the problem. So that is the, now there are, so these are created, we cannot say these are the British introduced, this is the Western education introduced. There are two sources of the patriarchal system. This I call as patriarchal system, which means in capsule definition, the male dominance, and where male dominance is promoted. And patriarchal system is two sources. One is the cultures, and the cultures and social norms, and other is the modern way of patriarchy, which talks of the head of the household, and lack of inheritance rights, and so on and so forth. So this is important. And the policy changes when we talk about, fundamentally, we have to really kind of unlearn these things and make new changes. Has the government made any changes? Can we say that what is the policy norms have been? Yes. It has been really the change, but these policies are not implemented. And that is because of the both implementers and the policymakers are really governed by the cultural systems. In 2005, Hindu Succession Amendment Act was changed. And women got the right to inheritance, which was against the Hindu law. We are talking of the 80% of the population. We are the, initially when Jawaharlal Nehru or Ambedkar wanted to bring change, both of them wanted to bring change. The constitutional, the other said that they will bring the constitutional crisis if this change happened, but this happened. So 2005 Amendment Act, that right to inheritance on par with the brother is very, very important. But how many women are claiming? Even in Haryana, some women have claimed. So they are claiming, not everyone is important. I would encourage you to PhD students and master's students to do work on the nexus of gender, land, and energy. I am working on that. And this nexus approach has come recently in the SD analysis. What is this nexus approach? It really looks at the linkages of various goals, the relevant goals. So a lot of work is happening on sanitation, water, and what else? Third thing. I don't remember, but sanitation and water is one thing that is being seen in Nexus. Nexus approach developed in 2011, and it has taken on many things. That means that we cannot work in silos. Things are interrelated. So I have been looking at the question of gender, land, and energy, how they are relevant, and why land and property ownership is important. And third is why energy is important for women. In one word, I would say that land and property ownership, one sentence, is important because this is used as the, in order to provide for the male dominance. That is, you dependent, people, whether one is beaten up or whether I don't get a right to food or don't have the voice, where do I go? Do I go? I don't have any right in the parental house at the mercy of the brother. I don't have the right in the husband's house. Where do you go? And you say that women are backward. They are not backward. They are very calculative that in terms of, and that's why they are not able to make decisions. So land and property ownership, unmediated ownership, is very, very important, because if you don't have those, then it defaces. So that's why land rights have become very important. It has emerged in the women's movement. Why energy is important? Energy is the basic source of this thing, and I would really send you some pointers from that, or the taking up the questions also I would do, because energy and gender are very, very critically important, which you would think that. Energy important because it gives, there is an increasing recognition that energy can play an important role in combating poverty, inequality. Without energy, you can't do much. How much you can study, how much you can run the household. Improvement in the health. About 1.3 million women and children, particularly women, die in India every year because of the indoor air pollution, because of the cooking on the firewood. And WHO figures have been talking about. So clean cooking energy is very important. Increased productivity through mechanization of agriculture, because they are engaged in agriculture, so energy is also very important in having this access. Now the policy changes and critique of that. What is the this thing? There have been two policy changes recent. One is, how many of you have heard about Ujjala scheme? it comes a newspaper, a billboard, that how much women have received Samman, so that is the... So what is Ujjwala? Ujjwala scheme is really LPG distribution to below poverty household. And another thing in Ujjwala scheme is that connection is given, connection and cylinder is given in the name of woman. And it is not that she is single or something. She, whether she is married or not, it is the woman of the household who would get the connection. That would be the... And this is clean cooking energy, because it is very much carbon emitting in the household that I've seen. That's why women and infants who are next to the mother, they tend to die. They have many diseases, and that's it's a kind of health risk. Somebody was telling me that why it is not declared as epidemic in India when so many women are dying, because the and children are dying, but something. And this is the largest program of the government of India, and I appreciate that kind of thing. But and then second policy, and this made in 2016. So I'm coming to very, very recent kind of things, because there's a farm women-friendly machinery. Women can buy any machinery on a subsidized rate higher than the men. That is 10 to 40% subsidized, higher subsidies. The result, what is the result then, and why I'm critiquing then the state, you will not ask me. One is that clean cooking energy is really important, but it is a very, very minimal change having the cylinder in the name of the woman. Why we cannot have the house in the name of the woman? And she also rents and maintains the kind of thing. And a lot of violence would reduce. We have the state of Meghalaya where the violence is minimal. There is a violence. So nobody will say that either you adjust or you go out. And these are the modern women, well educated. They face this problem. Either you adjust or you go out. And parents say, I will, about the job, you will be educated here, but whether you were allowed to work or not, your in-laws would decide. So it is in-laws, husband, and that kind of hierarchy is maintained. So clean cooking energy is important. It is the 50 million and 30 million has been achieved, and the recent is now 80 million household would get it. So all. But role of citizens is also very important in this, because progressive people like us, we should not look down upon, they gave up their subsidies. So elite and citizens, for the first time I'm impressed in my life by them, that they gave up their rights voluntarily in order to kind of, they were not all members of the BJP who gave the right. I also gave up my right for subsidies. I am nowhere close to BJP, but I'm just saying that kind of. So they gave up their right so that a poor household can benefit. Farm women-friendly machinery, what is the meaning of that? They can buy. They can go to the block office or the district office, and they can buy a tractor, power tiller, any kind of machinery. These are not women-specific machineries. They are any kind of machinery they can buy in their name. But why they are not buying? They are putting the application, and they are... I did the field work in Odisha, Tamil Nadu, and... Odisha, Tamil Nadu, and Kerala. What is the situation that comes? The women put in the application, but application is returned because they are not landowners, so they are not farmers. The machinery is meant, this subsidy is meant only for women farmers. And since you don't own land, so you are not even those 12.8% are considered in that. Those who have the operational holdings. Operational means managers. That is how the decision. So what do these policy changes suggest? Policy changes suggest two things, or a couple of things. A paradigm shift in our thinking. So this struggle that has been going on, two most successful movements are really women's movement and environmental movement. I think they have made change in our thinking. And even in the thinking of the young people, with all the complexities, that there has been a change. So a paradigm shift in belief, attitudes, and approaches. You know, World Bank, I'm no admirer of World Bank, but World Bank produces sometimes good reports, and you should look at that. A hardcore economic institution like World Bank, which talks of only economic growth, has come up with policy that unless come up with a report, and in series of the three reports, not only one, 16, 17, and 18, that unless there is a change in the attitudes and mindsets of people, then only any kind of change, economic change, is possible. Otherwise, it is not possible. So you see the nexus that we are talking about, attitudinal changes or behavioral economics, and the economics that if you want to make policy, then you have to think differently. So there is a shift in the attitude in terms of giving the cylinder in the name of woman. At least she will know what is happening. She will say yes. But what is the data is coming? That data is coming, self-help groups, women, those who are member of the collective called self-help group, they have the right to, they have more in number of these cylinders. Others are not. And second number, single women, where the widows or kind of who are living single, they also have the. Married women, by and large, they are not having in that kind of number. So you see that how the technology is denied. Second is that state attempt at addressing power gaps between the people of two genders. When you give the cylinder, then also the state is trying to say, okay, not house, not land, but inheritance rights and the cylinder at least is given in the name of women, and they are trying to balance the kind of that there is a need to empower women. So why state is interested? Because it talks to two people at the same time. It talks to the elite groups who have the access to all these power holders, institutions, these banks, universities, and where people are sitting, IDRC, Landesa, all these organizations where the elite has the access to. And some women also are there. And second is the organized groups of farmers, the Dalits, women. I mean, these are because they need their vote. So it tried to please them also. So policy has to be seen in this context, and that would be important for policy analysis. So one question that I would leave you with is that if you are doing work on energy, and you are doing a lot of you, that to what extent women are free to access and use energy? This would be my last point. Access is not really that you are entitled to do that. When you start using energy, that means you are enforcing your rights, you have the right to real use. So that make the difference between access and use. And second question would be, to what extent political economy determines women's unfreedoms, women's gender gaps? These will be important. India, incidentally, has a very poor record in the gender gaps, very low on that. And World Economic Forum now, year and year onwards, brings out what is the record. So this gender gap has acquired all the critique that of the economist, economist attention to talk about these things, which is a good thing. Thank you.
Word to Professor Sudha Pai and hear her insights.
Thank you, Dr. Das, and for inviting me. I think there's a bit of a difference in my presentation and what has gone earlier, because it's more about the politics of inequality here. But it also connects up with what I have called exclusionary growth. And it also throws light on the role of the state and on public policy, public action, how public goods are distributed. So while my paper may be a lot about politics, I think the underlying story really is who gets what, how, and so on. So I've also limited it to what I call the more backward states of the Hindi heartland. And I've actually focused on Uttar Pradesh for the reason that these are the states that are really holding back, according to many reports, the sustainable goals, the development of these sustainable goals. So therefore, what is it that is happening in these states is extremely important. And this covers a whole range of population also, and these are some of the poorest areas as such. So what do we mean by political inequality or the politics of inequality? I think political inequality is an important foundational principle of democracy because it ensures social and economic equality. Democratic institutions set the rules of the political process, and they guarantee formal rights to citizens, though in all cases it may not reach everybody. I think social scientists have long argued that political power is the key dimension to stratification, meaning that the position held by an individual or social group within the social structure impacts the individual's or group's political influence. So political inequality is the result of structured differences in the distribution of political resources. That is, when one class or classes group, a social group or groups have greater or lesser access to acquisition of political resources than other groups or to political inputs into decisions that affect them. And of course, in India, it's more complex because apart from class-based inequalities, we have divisions such as caste, community, and then, of course, gender, which have historically created patterns of political and arising out of it economic inequality. So I would argue that political inequality has been a very decisive factor as the most marginalized and economically disadvantaged sections of society have remained outside the political system. Their interests underrepresented, and they have not been able to access economic resources. At the same time, and I think Jairam Ramesh referred to this in the morning in some detail, that a significant feature of development in India has been the widening of disparities among states. Now, I would add, of course, as most people would, after globalization, but I think this is a pattern that you find from the colonial period onwards. And it also means that public policy after independence has not been able to overcome the historical pattern of uneven socioeconomic growth among regions in the country. I think that is something also that we need to keep in mind. Sorry. At the states in southern and western India are moving ahead at a faster pace. If you look at Kerala, for example, or Tamil Nadu, which have achieved a comparably high rate of human development, as against states lying in the Hindi heartland, such as UP or Bihar, where human development rates remain abysmal. While there have been many social movements in the country since the colonial period demanding inclusion and social equality, and demanding political inclusion also, the process of incorporation has been very slow. The pace at which it is taking place is also different in different states in the country. In recent decades, there have been movements by Dalits and backwards in the states of the Hindi heartland, and political parties representing them have come to power, such as the BSP, SP, RJD, etc. This has given the lower castes a modicum of political empowerment visible in higher levels of participation, like voting, etc. Higher levels of political consciousness and protests, which we have seen recently, but very little share in economic resources, greater social equality, or participation in the making of public policies. So what I'm going to do is examine what are the major hurdles that political inequality and exclusionary policies pose to the development of a backward state, namely UP. And from here you can well generalize to other backward states lying in the northern part of the country. Why UP? It's a large state with a population of over 19 crores, and according to the census, it's one of the most backward states of the Indian Union. I won't go into details, low income, low productivity levels, predominance of agricultural sector, low levels of urbanization, very important for us here, high levels of mortality, fertility, morbidity, undernutrition, social inequality, slow pace of poverty decline, although there has been decline in poverty. And there are sharp differences in the level of human development among the different social and religious groups in the state, the Dalits, the backward, the Muslims, and so on. They remain largely among the poor, and their interests underrepresented. According to the National Human Development Report of the Planning Commission 2001, we find that UP is very lowly placed. And in fact, we find by 2001, it had slipped to 16th position. You know, it rose a little bit during the 2000s, during the late 1990s. But by 2001, it slipped to 16th position among the major states, Bihar being just below it. Most of the industrial agricultural investment, even within UP, has been in the western region. The others continue to remain backward. Yet at the same time, UP has very fertile land with plenty of surface and underground water, good rainfall, large livestock resources, vast source of cheap and unskilled labor, and quite a bit of skilled and educated manpower. So what I'm trying to say is that UP is a state with great potential, which remains largely unexploited. In fact, the Human Development Report of UP itself in 2005 pointed out that the attainment of the Millennium Development Goals in the country depends critically on a fast improvement in the social indicators in UP and neighboring states as such. So what I'm arguing here is that the reasons for the backwardness of UP lie in the continuing politics of inequality and exclusionary growth that the state has represented. Let's look at it after independence. It has suffered from neglect, particularly in the post-independence period, leading to very slow growth. In the mid-1960s, UP was described by a well-known economist as the sleeping giant in the country. And little later, Amartya Sen and Dres described it as the burden, as suffering from the burden of inertia. There's nothing really happening at all, and so on. A second important reason, when we look at the 1990s, is the pervasive politics of identity based on caste and community and its linkages, I think very important linkages, with the political economy of development, which affected the capacity and autonomy of the state to undertake effective and inclusive governance. In fact, inequalities between UP and other states and within regions has increased as such. So what I will do is, I will do it as briefly as possible. I will first look at the period between 1950 and 1990, then the period from the 1990s onwards, and then come to the more recent part. And in the final section, I will describe what has been the impact that this neglect and divisive identity politics, lack of public action, poor governance has had on social indicators and generally governance within the state, the population in the state. Writing in the mid-1960s, Saraswati Srivastava pointed to the politics of neglect under Congress rule leading to backwardness. You see, you don't have an anti-Brahmin movement in North India. And the leadership of the Congress was largely drawn from the upper caste classes, particularly the landholding Brahmins and Thakurs. And most of their support came from the middle class professionals, industrialists, the sugar mill owners, business groups, merchants in the bigger cities, etc. It did have the support politically of the Muslims and the scheduled castes. But how did it do it? It was by dispensing patronage through a network of patron-client relationships in the countryside. And so then you use the landlords to mobilize the lower castes and make them vote for you, and therefore you create vote banks. Another reason was, of course, the fact that there was a very high level of factionalism and large majority which kept them from greater public action. But at the same time, I think we shouldn't forget society as well when we talk about the state. The conservative and right-wing center outlook of the party was reinforced by pervasive inequality and resilient conservatism in society as such. If we were to look at the performance of UP during this period, you'll find that, I know we've been saying that per capita income is not important, we need to look at the bottom and so on, but even then, in 1950-51, the per capita income in UP was 259 rupees, whereas the national per capita income was only 247. But throughout the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, it kept falling. And by 2001, to put it briefly, per capita income in UP was 40% lower than the national average. What it means is that states like this typify the slow growth and the backwardness that certain parts of the country has suffered, and which really began in the post-independence period. Of course, many people have said that plan outlays were very inadequate. It's a large state. It has large population. It cannot, because it's poor, it cannot tax too much. It cannot raise money, whatever the reason may be. But this has been the path of progress. And in fact, the center did give UP quite a bit during the first few plans as such. In the 1950s, there was the community development program, national extension program, panchayats started. But ultimately, these programs merely strengthened the hold of the upper strata of the peasantry, and the erstwhile zamindars and the lower castes remained underrepresented. So neither, I mean, you have a very resilient society, conservative society, and you do not have attempts by the state to help the really lower bottom part as such. Similar story is there of the Green Revolution. It increased agricultural yields, there's no doubt about it. But economic development took place only within certain regions and districts and increased existing class and regional inequalities between big and small farmers and between farmers and landless laborers. So on the one hand, UP becomes the wheat bowl of the country together with parts of Punjab, that's parts of UP. But on the other hand, it does not necessarily solve the problems of those working on land and those who own small plots, etc. There were challenges to the Congress. You have the Agrarian Party, the BKD, you have the Republican Party of India. But none of these movements, whether it was these or other parties that came up, like the Jansang or the Swatantra, none of them could generate any opposition that could have strong forces capture power and deal with the social and political inequalities in UP. So you do not have much change throughout the early period. But it's interesting that during the 1980s, surprisingly, UP's economy grew at a much faster rate than earlier. For the first time, there's a slight shift away from agriculture to industry, and UP registers a rate of economic growth higher than the national average. If you take the fifth and sixth plans together, I mean, food grain production also goes up, largely because of the second round of the Green Revolution, which goes into eastern UP. It is largely rice, and it helps improve the conditions of the really poor, the appalling poverty in eastern UP. Second change is a slight increase in literacy, particularly among the Dalits, which contributes to political awareness. This impetus came from the greater role and funds provided to states under the Gadgil formula in the 1970s, under which a number of institutions, and I think it's important to understand that many of these were outside the state. That is, there was a state planning commission set up, an economic advisory committee, a public investment board, a state planning institute, and so on. And so a complete restructuring of the planning process in UP was carried out. The idea was to create institutions outside the main administrative system of UP to chalk out new policies for UP. And it did have an impact because in the 1980s, a lot of change took place. Part of it, of course, was the Green Revolution, but a lot of it was the effort that was put in. So we find that many observed that UP could create a democratic, more inclusive, transparent, and accountable system of governance for the first time. However, this was merely a window of opportunity because it proved very short-lived. It disappeared in the 1990s when economic growth decelerated sharply due to identity politics. It fell, and then you have a sort of endemic political instability in UP. And on the other hand, the national economy goes on to a higher growth path in the 1990s. But states like UP, they decelerate and they become worse and worse. The collapse of the Congress, of course, led to the a fragmented multi-party system, narrower identity-based parties and so on, the SP, the BSP, and so on. But what really happens in the 1990s, which is important for us, is frequent elections, hung assemblies, no party gaining a majority, resulting in political instability, short-lived governments which did not pursue any coherent or long-term public policies. What did governments practice? They practiced the politics of competitive populism. That is, when the SP came to power, everything went to Yadavs. When the BSP came to power, a lot of the money was spent, not all, but a large amount of the money was spent on consolidating the vote base of the BSP. So there's a kind of competitive populism. The immediate political pressures for distribution of patronage were intense. They weakened the capacity of the state to undertake developmental tasks and formulate effective and long-term policies or to implement inclusive policies as such. As both the SP and the BSP focused almost exclusively on capturing power, the gains for the lower caste, for the lowest caste proved to be almost entirely of a symbolic nature. Identity assertion and symbolic politics of self-respect and dignity definitely were there against the established caste-based order, but it brought little material benefits for the poor and the oppressed. Identity politics benefited merely a small minority among the lower castes, the already better off among the Dalits and backwards who made use of the welfare policies or benefited through some amount of land distribution or reservation in government jobs. So what happens? There's a very steep deterioration of the UP economy, widening of disparities over the failure of the governments to tax or accelerate public investment. The real impact of this is on infrastructure, health, and educational services. Consequently, UP, which was a revenue surplus state, enters a debt trap, a sort of vicious circle of low growth rate and fiscal crisis preventing further investment, from which it has taken a very, very long time to recover. Actually, a study in the 1990s compares the differential impact of this political mobilization by lower castes on the making of public policy and the level of human development of the poorer sections in two states, Tamil Nadu and UP. Both states experienced strong social movements, Tamil Nadu in the early 20th century and UP over the last decade, which mobilized the Dalits and the OBCs against the upper castes and threw up parties which captured state power. In UP, the lower castes, apart from some improvement in elementary education, still continue to have the worst indicators of human development, not only compared to upper castes in the state, but also in comparison to most other states and also to Dalits in Tamil Nadu. In contrast, Tamil Nadu in a much shorter period than Kerala and in post-independence India, through effective public policies, has managed to improve the social indicators of health, education, fertility, and nutrition of its population. The reasons for the difference lie in the nature of the social movements and their implications for human development. In Tamil Nadu, despite many failings, the mass mobilization was broad enough to create space for all-round advance in the well-being of the entire population. This was then followed by planned and effective technical interventions by the state designed to introduce change in health, education, nutritional requirements of the poor, including the Dalits and backwards. In UP, Dalit and backward leaders have focused exclusively on capturing power, and populist policies have undermined the capacity of the state to invest in social sectors. Here, I'm not minimizing the whole issue of self-respect and dignity and so on, but we are here dealing with the material benefits of public policies, and hence this is what I'm really trying to highlight. In the 2000s, in contrast to the 1990s, two governments headed by the BSP and SP in 2007-2012 gained a majority, which of course gave them a chance of a more stable government to do some sort of a long-term improvement. Some change did take place during this period in terms of better education, housing, infrastructure, and so on. But if you look at a report in 2005 by the Giri Institute in Lucknow on economic growth and its linkages to human development, it identified certain failures of public policy. What were they? Poor quality of public services and inequity in access to them. Visible deterioration in the functioning of public institutions, understaffed and ill-equipped schools and hospitals, leading to decay in public primary education system and healthcare in the state. Now, the new government formed in March, the BJP government formed in March 2017, on assuming power, promised development of all, appeasement of none, no discrimination based on caste, religion, and gender, and so on. It has been credited by many for improving the power situation, for improving roads, bringing a certain seriousness, focus, and engagement with industry. And of course, it has only completed 1 year in office, and many argue that maybe there'll be long-term benefits. But many critics have argued that its development record shows that it has not been able to put forward a strategy to address the numerous problems facing UP, such as the chronic power shortages, infrastructural bottlenecks, broken healthcare and education systems, and unemployment. The state's debt is almost 30% of the GDP, and the farm waiver, ironically, has cut into capital services for police services, public construction, and ironically, agriculture-associated sectors. So UP has paid a very heavy price in which development policies have been, manner in which development policies have been addressed by governments. And today it is lagging behind large, you know, most of the states in terms of indicators of social development, growth, and so on. Today UP belongs to both low expenditure category and low income category. So both of these coming together actually determine what is the quality of life as such. Poverty has gone down, but as was mentioned in the morning, that's, you know, there are various ways of looking at it. Despite the substantial decline, the absolute number of the poor remains very high. That is, the number of people whom the official statistics still count as poor remains very high. Almost 6 million people in UP were living below the poverty line in 2004-2005, constituting almost one-fifth of the total poor in the country, not just UP. The decline, the incidence of poverty is, of course, much higher among scheduled castes, OBC categories, artisans, Muslims, and so on. And there are wide variations across regions and districts as such. And there are three interrelated social failures, which have to do with what was said earlier also. Sorry, I have a little bad throat, which have played a role in the persistence of endemic deprivation. Low levels of education, restricted role of women in society, and poor functioning of public services, particularly healthcare. If you look at literacy, the Human Development Report of UP, that was in 2001, though it was actually published much later, ranked UP as 31 in 2001 among 35 states. Since then, there has been improvement. If you look at particularly the most recent census, there has been tremendous improvement in literacy. But the gap between UP and the rest of the country remains substantial. Secondly, the gap between men and women remains, and the gap between the general population and the scheduled castes remains fairly substantial as such. Many governments, particularly those in the 2000s, have spent much more on education. And so now there is at least one school in every habitation, even small villages. But while accessibility has increased, the problem is poor infrastructure, lack of teachers, including female teachers, weak accountability, and absenteeism on the part of teachers, essential learning materials, poor teaching practices, and so on. Where gender relations are concerned, there is I'll just mention, I can't go into details, is the suppression of women's agency in society. I think a lot has already been said, with extensive implications for not only the well-being of women, but also for economic development and social progress in society as a whole. Where public health is concerned, the medical healthcare system in UP is massive and well-spread, but the delivery system needs much improvement. The reasons are really low quality of service and so on. And in fact, UP is the worst performer in the Niti Aayog's latest health index. You know, the Aayog brought out a report titled Healthy States, Progressive India, which measured the health index. And this was the reference years at 2015-16 and so on. And it has placed UP almost at the bottom. Also, I think we are all aware of the death of 30 children in the Medical College of Gorakhpur in a span of 2 days in September 2017 due to a reported lack of oxygen shows that all is not well in UP's public healthcare system. So let me just conclude. What I've tried to show is a close relationship between the politics of neglect and politics of identity that UP has suffered, in fact, many states have, and its continuing trajectory of economic backwardness. It, to that extent, epitomizes the politics of the backward states, caste, communal mobilization by parties in their desire to capture power, riots, breakdown of law and order, negligence, and poor governance. The social movements don't seem to have helped most of the disadvantaged and poorer sections of the population. So clearly what is needed is a mix of policy interventions and political mobilization supporting such interventions for improving the human development levels of the poorer sections, including the scheduled castes and the backwards and so on. Such interventions are the responsibility of the state government. I think there was a question in the morning. Since health and education are state subjects, although they also appear on the concurrent list given under the Indian Constitution, because today state governments account for almost 90% of total expenditure on health and education. The success of Tamil Nadu and Kerala, as I mentioned earlier, in various aspects of human development, education, health and nutrition, shows that mass mobilization by political parties, show that mass mobilization by political parties interested mainly in capturing power is only meaningful to the masses if it leads to substantial advances in human well-being and improves capabilities of the poor. So I'll just conclude by saying that UP seems to be caught in a kind of vicious circle between low levels of human development and low levels of economic development. So we need to break this circle by giving priority to human development along with a big push to the state economy. Obviously, UP requires a new leadership to bring in political order and development so that it can then resume its position among the better governed states and meet the social development, the sustainable goals of development as such. Thank you. I hope I didn't take too much time.
Thank you so much, Professor Pai, for bringing in the most, I think, to my mind, this is the most critical aspect of politics, because who gets what, when, how is the fundamental question that holds us back from the goal of equality when we are talking about SDGs. It was very nice in the way you brought out structured differences and how you compared the politics in the initial early period of independence and then 1990 onwards, to highlight how UP has gone through the growth trajectory and what has been holding it back in terms of its performance. I really liked the reference to UP's potential from a sleeping giant to, I'm at the same address calling it a burden of inertia. And I think it went on, it became more complex when we started talking about politics of identity and divisive politics and how they played a role in probably holding it back from lot of developmental benefits. I think Mr. Ramesh was also had also raised this question in the morning, saying what helps certain states to get bigger share of the pie. Now here is a bigger state which is not able to effectively stake its claim and come up and rise. And a lot of it is attributed to fundamental weaknesses, drawbacks emerging from patronage politics, patron-client relationships, conservatism, and identity politics. Now, the if I can point out one more interesting element was the politics of competitive populism. Although you know, it's nice to see different parties and how political equations are changing, but it's not very encouraging to see the outcomes. In the morning we were talking about outcomes when we are talking about SDGs and reducing inequalities. And there comes the example of Tamil Nadu and Kerala, which Professor Pai brought in to highlight how the nature of social movement itself was different, and how that was followed by planned and effective technical and policy intervention that really helped shape the changes in these two states, and what we can learn, what UP as a state can learn from these. But it is a kind of microcosm into the larger national politics. So we started off talking about as goal 10 of reducing inequalities, which talks more at between, you know, compares the nations across nations. But here we are getting into micro politics and essential elements within the nation states and what keeps us apart. So as a way forward, there is a mix of policy intervention and political support, and particularly priority to human development along with impetus on economy is the lesson for a lot of states which are lagging behind, which still have a lot of potential. Like she said, it has fertile land, but there is so much of divisive politics which is holding it back. And of course, added with it is the infrastructure, education, other models.